Okay. This is a very specific chip on my shoulder. I don't know if anyone who isn't toxically film Twitter brained and hasn't touched enough grass lately because they're saving for their first trip overseas in LA hasn't stated a grass touching tax will understand this. But Letterboxd, that app for logging and reviewing the movies you've watched, go to any one movie, and at the top reviews, you'll probably see at least a couple one-liner comments with hundreds or even thousands of likes. This happened to my buddy Eric, is like the Oppenheimer nexus point of it. Especially with the biggest releases of every year, like Barbie, Mario, Everything Everywhere All at Once, etc., there's usually quite a lot of joke reviews. And I scroll past them, usually. Sometimes one will get a slight sniff out of my nostril in amusement, and sometimes one will be a little annoying. Sometimes I will even indulge in one myself. It's basically the same to me as using any other website ever created. But like, some people really dislike these. Really dislike them. Every few months, there's a big tweet that goes around complaining about them with hundreds or thousands of likes. Basically, every time a big movie comes out, it brings a lot of eyes onto a Letterboxd page, inevitably resulting in joke reviews, inevitably resulting in posts complaining about these reviews. And I'm gonna be honest, I don't get it. I understand that they aren't always funny, I understand that there's annoyance in trying to read an actual critical analysis but being presented with something smarmy or reductive, I understand that making a video to complain about other people complaining is very hypocritical. I'm just gonna own that, I'm being super anal here. But like, these reviews are just so easy to scroll past. I wouldn't even say by mass the text of these joke reviews outweighs all of the critical text across all the reviews on the site. And it's a system that is much less malleable to much more harmful and common tactics of review spamming, like review bombing on the IMDb or Rotten Tomatoes pages of any remotely diverse media. It's just kinda annoying jokes, same as you'd find by name searching the movie on Twitter or going to r/movies. If your response to that is, well, it takes forever to scroll past the joke reviews with how many there are. You know what? I'm going to be petty and go to the officially curated list of the movies with the most fans on Letterboxd and see how long it takes to find at least one review that is two paragraphs long from the top 50. If you think two paragraphs is too little, I don't know what to say. If you want more, just make a damn Substack. For Interstellar, 4 seconds, almost instantaneous. For La La Land, 12 seconds, a bit longer. Fight Club, 22 seconds, kinda long, although to be fair, I did have to scan through spoiler tagged reviews to see if those were eligible. Parasite, instantaneous, it's the literal top review. Whiplash, 9 seconds, Everything Everywhere All at Once, instantaneous. The Dark Knight, 3 seconds, Eternal Sunshine, instantaneous. Spider-Verse, 2 seconds, Pulp Fiction, 12, Spirited Away, 7, Inception, 10, Godfather, 10, Shawshank, 4, Portrait of a Lady on Fire, 3, Call Me by Your Name, 3, Goodfellas, 3, Perks of Being a Wallflower, 5.
That's good. I think we get it.
Oh, no, this is a name all 50 kind of show.
Across the 50 movies with the most fans on Letterboxd, the average time it takes to find a review in the popular tab that is at least two paragraphs long is 6 seconds. The median is 5 seconds, the minimum is 0 seconds for 6 different movies, and the absolute maximum is 29 seconds for Scott Pilgrim vs. the World. This also does not account for the fact that A, this is only going off of the popular review section, the Friends section will have reviews from trusted reviewers you follow, and the news section will have stuff from up-and-coming reviewers. B, many of these had lengthier one-paragraph reviews beforehand, or shorter reviews that are linked to longer ones at other publications, or few-sentence reviews that were not jokes at all. C, these are the movies with the most fans, as in the people who like these movies often rewatch these movies, inflating the amount of reviews that might not be as substantial. So if the longest it takes you to find a sufficient in-depth review in the popular section of one of the most rewatched movies on the website is 30 seconds, with most taking 6? I just don't see how that's an actual issue. The reason I'm making this a video and not just a Twitter thread is also threefold. For one, I have had zero motivation to make long videos lately, and I'm forcing myself to make shorter ones to give the masses all the content. Two, again, chip on my shoulder, this is a mostly harmless discourse that mainly just annoys me and doesn't affect the real world. Three, I think it kinda reflects an attitude I notice in a lot of online fandom or artistic communities that I think is a bit limiting. There's been this on and off social media joke of coworker movies or coworker behavior or coworker taste for a while, and I'm kind of split on it because, I'll be honest, I have laughed at some of these before. It is funny to be one of those nerds that's really into film and to talk to someone who's only a casual observer and be shell-shocked by what different worlds you live in. It's relatable, it happens. When it gets past a mere joke, though, and is, like, repeated as something that's actually indicative of one's character, nah, I'm not into that at all. Being terminally online does not make you better. It arguably makes you a lot worse. Yes, you specifically. Everyone else here thinks I'm talking to them, but I'm actually talking to you. Seriously, though, I tweeted about this a while back, and it took off because I'm cursed to have a tweet get a randomly huge amount of likes every few months, and I don't understand why. This view that you, the enlightened intellectual with taste in the arts, are in some way above these normie coworkers who see whatever slop is fed to them is immature, solipsistic hogwash that I wish people wouldn't seriously entertain. The person seeing the latest live-action Disney remake or pop culture-ridden superhero movie isn't a worse or dumber person than you guys. They just have different interests and priorities and tastes. I don't necessarily care for the live-action Lion King at all, and it baffles me that it made $1.6 billion and is getting a sequel when nobody I am personally close with even saw it in theaters. And yet, even though I don't like that type of film and would rather they not take up so much of the industry, I think people who do see movies like that are perfectly valid in their reasons for doing so. I think it's rude to insinuate that someone else's media viewing experiences are inherently harmful when the only thing they're doing is seeing a movie from some other billionaire corporation, one that, as much as I don't care for it, has a perfectly understandable hook that casual moviegoers and fans might be drawn into to view the spectacle of. I'm not going to say that every single person who saw this is stupid or has bad taste, because that's just a rude and blatantly untrue thing to say about a large number of people you don't know who have done nothing but watch one piece of statistically harmless media, especially given that most of the industry's worst trends are outright orchestrated in a way to draw in casual moviegoers while original ideas are barely given a chance to shine. My point is, not everyone is going to be as into your hobby as you are. That's just an undeniable fact. So I think it's healthier to accept that and either just ignore normie film takes that annoy you or ease people into further depths of the art without insulting their intelligence. I personally have been getting crazy into films these past 2 years. My own Letterboxd diary output has like tripled. I'm still pretty early on in my journey. I've recently been going through Steven Spielberg and Hayao Miyazaki's revolutionary catalogs, but this is something that has brought me great joy. I've written many in-depth reviews about movies I've watched and connected greatly with, talking about the different aspects of the craft that I find notable and the ways in which they inspire me in my own future aspirations. And yet, sometimes I'll watch a movie and not have much to say. I'll do a brief, few-sentence review. Sometimes I'll even watch a movie, think of a joke while doing so, and post the joke after the movie. Sometimes I'll have a whole riff of jokes that I don't know what to do with, like when I watched Eowyn and the Witch. Believe it or not, choosing to make a brief review of something at one point in time isn't indicative of my internal character and ability to connect with art. That's another thing, there's always a lot of assumption that someone making a quippy review means they didn't engage with the work. I want to push back on that. Letterboxd is a diary app. Some people are going to leave a diary by writing in-depth reviews of every single thing they watch. Some people are going to leave a diary by marking what they watched with a small attached comment. Maybe they watched it and it completely blew their mind and changed how they think about the arts, but they're not in the mood to sit down and type at their computer, so they just leave a comment and continue with their day. Letterboxd isn't a review section in the vein of, I don't know, the ones on Amazon or Steam. Leaving a shallow review on Letterboxd isn't going to potentially alter someone else's later purchasing decisions or hurt the company involved. They're not even that common when you get to slightly less mainstream movies. Of course, Barbie has a lot of joke reviews. It was the most popular movie of one of Letterboxd's most popular years. I don't get it. Letterboxd is easier for me to curate than other forms of social media since I can easily follow my friends or people I watch and their reviews show right there easily, and you can literally block accounts, so if there's a particular reviewer who's annoying you, you can just make them disappear forever. Why is this such a big deal? Am I giving too much slack to the normies? Am I excusing the devaluation of art criticism or whatever? I don't care. This is the least one of my video topics that has ever actually mattered in the grand scheme of things, and I once did a video analyzing DVD menu games. This is just me yelling at a cloud. I'm not even, like, upset with anyone who I featured in these censored screenshots. If you complain about these reviews, well, at least you didn't waste your time making a video complaining about the complaining about it, so arguably you win. I don't even really have any more of a conclusion. I guess if you liked the video, you can follow my Letterboxd, I guess. See my terrible film opinions, like that Revenge of the Sith is my favorite Star Wars movie, or that Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is pretty good. All my worst takes are Lucasfilm related, it's weird. Also, damn, that's two videos in a row defending things that people on the internet hate. Illumination Entertainment, Letterboxd joke reviews. See you all next week with In Defense of Dropping Pennies off the Empire State Building. It's fun. Today I'll be giving a shout out to my patrons at the producer tier and above, those being Ace L, Alicia Stella, Kira, Freya, Joy Content, Oliver Corcoran, Sam, Vincent Coates, and Yensid. With that said, I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I will see you all later.